That's why I saved everything, you know, because it was important to me, anything that my queens did. And they were so wonderful, my little girls. And my feeling in the early days when I started, you know, we're very remote, we're kind of country. And what I saw the first year, or the second year more, I traveled with Helen more than I did with Kathy, but if I, and I did that, and I hate to say I, because, but then they say he that tooteth not his own horn will not have tooted for him, so I will say that I learned, it made me feel really good to know that one girl from this community would have the opportunity to go out there and see what was going on and interact with other people. And what an education that was for a little high school girl from Southport at first and then South Brunswick, that I thought was very important. And bringing the people in, her inviting her friends here that she had met all over the state, that was important too. So the hospitality program really was a great promotion for our festival. So you have any questions you'd like to ask me? I'll answer if I can.
I think I kind of did as we went along.
Well, because you can tell I loved it.
Oh, yeah, it's fantastic. and you know, you can, I think I describe it, you describing old Southport. We had an event on Saturday that was honoring the River Pilots and the 100th anniversary of the Pilots Association. And what I liked most about that event is that the audience was old Southport, you know, there to celebrate Southport, to celebrate, you know, the pride that they had and things. Okay.
Well, and there was nothing like it. You know, I was not born here, but they didn't know it. Because I was a beach girl in the early 50s. And then in 54, when we were all older and we were all graduating from high school, and we all used to get together over on the beach at the old pavilion over there and dance to the 50s songs and stuff. And then, you know, the camaraderie and the love affair, although I was from Whitehall, I never wanted to go back to Whitehall. It was always Southport. Southport was my home from that time. And when I did come back to Southport 10 years later and made my home here, the people here, because they knew me when we were teens, they don't know I wasn't born at J. Arthur Dozier Memorial Hospital. I mean, and they don't know I didn't graduate with them at the Southport High School. Because I'd say, well, you know, when we did so-and-so, and I'd say, I really don't know. I'd love to, but I don't. And so, but I was one of them, and we had so much fun. And gosh, Bill Fall and Mr. Harold Aldridge. See, Bill Fall had, at Brunswick Town, he had a laboratory, and he could take pictures, and he developed them and everything right out there. And so one of those early programs, and it might be in that book, but I don't know, we went, Mr. Harrell, myself, and my two kids, we all went out to Brunswick Town late one night and put that festival program together out there. Bill had taken the pictures, he developed the pictures, and we put them all on the pages, and I said, I guess people think that we have got a big affair going on, the three of us out here late at night, but we were having a great time, I tell you, about putting, cutting and pasting and doing all the things that you had to do way back then. and copying, but he had all the equipment out there. But the thing about it was that everybody got involved to do what they could do, and they loved working together. Roma Clement, Miss Roma, she worked for, I believe, she worked out at, for the county in some place, and she used to give me a really hard time about going off with the girls. And Harold going and pulling the things. Yeah, you, Mr. Harold, you go off and, you know, do this and that with the queen. And then she would be in charge of the, she was the finance chairman, so she would be in charge of the barbecue. And buddy, I'm telling you, she cracked the whip on us. You gotta be here at this time, fold boxes, and you gotta be here to dish up barbecue and the slaw, and you know. And then we had our runners with the cars that would take ever how many plates of barbecue to wherever they had to go. And it was just like a big old family out there just having such a great time together. And because we worked, we didn't realize what we were building. We were just having fun. But then, I began to understand it. I'm not a marketing graduate, but I have always had an innate ability for organization, even when I was in school, high school, interaction with people. So I began to realize what we were doing and how important it was, and put our best face forward. And that queen was the symbol of our festival. She was our ambassador, and nobody knew that but me, how it worked. And I would get her in the car. I educated her on our trips. You know, I would talk, I'd just bring it into conversation about the town and what it meant to be here, and the river and all this stuff, and I just bring it up in conversation so that she could understand exactly what her representation was. It's not just go somewhere and have a good time and, you know, be a beauty queen. It was responsibility to this town and this festival that you make sure that everything you say and do reflects us in a very good light. And then I would educate her on events. We would talk about events that were happening. So when she talked to people, she had a command of what was going on in the town. So she could talk to them about it. She could explain it. And I guess they just always thought I was just talking, but I was brainwashing them, really. Oh, that's Connie. She's just talking. No, honey.
Tell me a little bit about how revolution became part of the festival. So it was
revolution was actually totally separate from the festival. It was part. It was Bill Crow, as I mentioned before, was the was the chairman of the bicentennial celebration for Southport. Lew Hardee, who was a native of Southport, lived in New York. He was a graduate of Carolina in theater arts.
I knew Lou. So.
You knew Lou?
Yeah.
You knew my Lou? I love Lou. And so he was in charge. He had always wanted to do an outdoor drama. He researched the history along with Bill Falk of the activities that took place at Brunswick Town prior to the Boston Tea Party. And so he wrote the script for Revolution. He wrote the story. He wrote the prospectus on how it could be done and what we had to do. I never heard that word prospectus before I became producer of Revolution. And so, and he was very close, his family, with Betty Leggett, again, Leela Pickett. You heard me speak of Leela. And Dot Hardy, of course, was his mother, and they were all...
Sweetheart.
They were all artists and they did everything. They were musical, they were artists, they did everything, especially Dorothy, Sweetheart. And Lou had talked with Bill Crow about doing an outdoor drama in Southport. And Bill sanctioned it. And so they'd been talking about it a long time before I ever knew it. And all of a sudden, Lou called me one night from New York. I was already in bed and half asleep. And he called me and he said, I've been talking with Betty Leggett and Little Pickett and different people, and we're planning to do an outdoor drama in Southport for the bicentennial. And we have been trying to decide who would be the best person in Southport to be the producer. And we have decided it would be you. Would you accept it? And I always said yes, you know, something else I can do. So I said, yeah, sure, what does a producer do? And I found out I got a crash course in what a producer does. But we had a lot of fun because Dorothy, of course, was a lot of fun, and Lou was real close to his mom, and he had gotten, he was on the phone to me all the time, but anyway, he got Ethan Ayer to write the libretto for his music. And he had written the script, the story, the history. He researched it with Bill Falk and everything, and they had actually the book done. And then he wrote the script, and then he did the music, and then he had to have somebody that would take the script and put the words to the music. So that was Lou's problem. And then he had to get the singers and the actors. But I got one, Susan Griffin. She was Miss North Carolina. Fabulous, fabulous soloist. So all of a sudden I'm producing something, and he'd come home and we'd have our little meetings, and I'm flying blind. I'm not kidding you, I'm flying blind. But then I figured out that my big thing was to raise money. And so, but Lou guided me all the way. And I did when we started in production, and we started, we hired the director. And Lou and I interviewed just about everybody that we had. And of course, he picked a lot of the actors and performers from the school that he had. He, at that time, he was an instructor with the American Academy of Arts in New York. And later, when I went there later on in the 90s or whenever I went to work up there, he was at Wagner. So we had quite a good time. We did a lot of research. We took a trip one weekend all up to Hillsborough and all around all the historic sites and things that related to Revolution. And it was me and Dorothy and Lou and what was his cousin's name? Anyway, he went with us. And it was a laugh a minute from the time we left Southport and we got back. We had the best time. But he held my hand and we got through it. We had a
How many performances were
there? You'll see all that. We had a performance every night. We were only dark on Monday. So we had six performances a week. From the time we opened, and we opened, not sure what day, right around the 4th of July, but it it wasn't part of the 4th of July, but it was the biggest event of the 4th of July. I think we opened like the week before the 4th of July. And it was fun. We went right on into, I believe, August, because a lot of the actors and all had to go back to school. But I was there every night. I did. I was the producer, and I did the wigs, and I did the hair, and I did, and I housed the leading actress at my house. And but it was so fun because they didn't have anything to do in the daytime, and they'd come over to my house because Susan would stay at my house. Some of the lead, the guys. And they'd come over to my house and play the piano and sing. I mean, the house was just rocking and rolling with them playing the piano and singing. You would have thought they got enough of that during the night, but it was, anyway, it was fun. And there again, that was just like the way we started the 4th of July, in that all of Southport participated. People housed the actors and actresses, some of them, and then we had some empty houses that we rented and put rented furniture and stuff to go in them that we rented for the season, for like a dormitory for the boys and dormitory for the girls that all came from out of town. And then we had little civic groups that cooked the meals and fed them. I mean, it was just like the 4th of July festival. It was a town, and they made the costumes. I mean, we had fabric spread all over town. People making costumes and fitting these people, and we were feeding them, and we were housing them. And you know, in fact, I have to tell you, this is so cute. I've been cleaning out a lot of my stuff. And I ran across a little file box, little metal, the army grain file box like everybody had back those days. And it was a file box full of names and addresses of prospective people to help with revolution. I know that's what it was. And I don't know who wrote it. I do think he had a name in there, but it was backgrounds on a lot of people that I knew. In fact, most of them I knew, and he had ranked them, you know, how they could fit in with revolution, what they had to offer. And that was so interesting, because my son-in-law lives a little bit out of Wilmington, and he has a big burn barrel out there, and I closed down my business. And I wanted to get rid of all my files. I've been cleaning up my office. That's where I found this. And so he's burning all my files and stuff, so I won't have to go through the process of shredding everything. So that's how I found it. I had some stuff I was pulling out of something, and I found that little box, and I thought, what in the world's in here? And I know, I thought, where did this come from? And because it had everybody in there I knew, everybody's name on all these things. It said who they were, where they lived, if they could sing, if they could sew, whatever they could do. It was the file box. He had gone through everybody he knew in Southport and ever would know in Southport, and had them listed in there. And then he did the first stuff, and then gave it to somebody else to type on all those little cards.
Yeah.
Do you remember when people did that stuff?
Yeah.
He did. And I'm thinking, where did this come from? And then I knew where I cleaned out the revolution office, I probably stuck it in a bag.
I wanted to, when you talk about those cards, Bill Reeves, who did the chronology.
I know Bill Reeves.
I found his index cards. 15,000 of them.
Oh my God.
That's what they all typed out. And that's actually, there were enough that we were able to do a volume 5 from 1970 to 1990.
Wow.
So now it's a 5 volume. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But that was incredible. Like, we're going through Susie Carson's stuff, and
we
had donated all, and he had given those to Susie, And I started over and I couldn't believe it.
Susie, in fact, I got her book out last night and was looking, and she does have some 4th of July celebrations listed in there through the years, nothing consecutive. But I was really looking to see if she had anything about the Live Oak Festival. Now, I tell you, Stuart Colary is the person you should probably talk about for the Live Oak Festival, and her sister Pat, if you know them.
Yeah.
Okay. Because Stuart also was a Live Oak queen. And Trudy Huffam was, I don't know if she was queen or if she was in the court, but the Live Oak Festival was fun. I was 17 years old, didn't know which end was up. But it was fun. It was fun. They had a dance at the U.S. The Queen's coronation, and my crown was cut out of cardboard. Lila probably made it and covered in aluminum foil. And back then it's called tin foil. The crown was that, and then Lou and Dorothy, and Lewis told me this, Lou and Dorothy and Betty Lay made the float that the Queen rode on for the parade. So that was my float. Right. And Lou and I, yeah, we were the same age. He was a month or so older than me, but we were great friends. Every time I went to New York, I mean, I had the greatest time. And when I had a project that I worked on after I left Southport, I worked for, I ran the chamber in Lynchburg, and then when I left the chamber, I worked for a publishing company that published economic development publications, hardcover books for development, economic development use for chambers.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they were developed through, they call it profiles, but it's advertising. So I went to work for them doing this, and I worked all over the Northeast. And I said, you guys got to give me a break. I got thin blood. I got to go home. Because I was in Long Island, New York for the blizzard of 1996. I called my boss and I said, it is snowing outside. I'm not used to this. And then, to get even with me, sent me to Buffalo for 6 months. So I was in, but I loved being on Long Island because Lou and I, that he took me to the college. He was having his class was doing Pirates of Penzance. Mm-hmm. So he called me and he said, meet me over there. So I'm going to Staten Island. You know where I'm from. I'm going to Staten Island, driving all around like I've got a brain. And anyway, I found Wagner, and we went to dinner, and we went in, and he introduced me to some of the people in his class that was doing the play. And then when it was over, I said, now you're going to have to leave me off this island, but don't leave me. I've got to stop and get some gas, because I was afraid I'd be late, so I didn't stop on the way over there. And Lord knows, when we pulled off from that service station, he ran right off and left. And I'm out there like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning in a white Camaro convertible, driving around Staten Island. Now, I said, okay, Connie, think. What do you do now? What do you do now? You got your gas, but you got to figure out how to get to that bridge right there. And so I said, I think you need to find a service station that's got lots of lights on and lots of people around it, and ask somebody for directions. So that's what I did, and I finally got to the bridge to get back over to Long Island. Whew, that was an experience, but I had a good time out there. I know somebody, I came home to Lou, and Ed Harper said to me, we were down at Provisions, and he said, well, where are you working now? I said, on Long Island. He said, what in the world are you doing in Long Island, New York? And I said, I'm working so I can afford to live here. I sure couldn't find a job here that would pay me to make, pay my mortgage. Yep, that's the way it was, girls and boys.
Thank you very much.
Well, I hope I didn't stutter and stammer and ramble too much.
No, you didn't stutter and stammer at all.
One thing I didn't tell you, when I was president, and I know you're not recording this, but I always thought it was kind of good, funny. I wanted to have a hot air balloon when I was president of the festival. And so I hired a hot air balloon to come to the waterfront. And as you know, we have those wonderful southwest breezes that come up.
The smooth breeze ones.
Yes, that come up in the afternoon. And that guy never, he came around late in the afternoon to the headquarters to get me to write him a check to pay him for coming down here. And I said, I have never seen the color of your balloon. And he said, but it's been too windy to inflate it. And I said, well, I'm not going to write your check till I see the colors of your balloon. So should we go back to the waterfront? Because we had planned on, you know, letting people ride on it, so getting tickets to ride, but it was too windy. But that didn't mean he couldn't inflate it long enough for my visitors to see that balloon down there. And so I said, I will accompany you to the waterfront to see the colors of your balloon, and when I do, then I'll give you your check. And I did. Isn't that funny? But it was a fun festival, and my ex-husband, who is Doug Ledgett, who incorporated the festival for me, was the event chairman, although Ed Harper was my vice president, but he didn't want to be president, so Doug took the next year. But I had a budget, when I turned my budget into the board, they were gasping at what I wanted to do. And I said, don't worry, we're going to raise the money for this festival, because I wanted to do a video, and I still have it. I wanted to do a video of the festival for promotion. And if you know somebody that can transpose it, I'll be glad to give it to you.
I know somebody.
Well, you shall have it. And so Ed was really more interested in doing that than, and he did a great job on it. But we did a video of the festival while it was going on. We had Baxter. Baxter and this girl that Ed had a crush on were the hosts. They were the hosts, and they and the cameraman, they talking, they took you all over Southport to the things in the park and the different things that were going on, and about how much fun it was to be in Southport on the 4th of July. And Nanny Lauren's sister is in it. I don't know if you remember her, but she was in the park, and she says, well, I don't know why anybody would be wanting to be anywhere else but Southport on the 4th of July. And it was so cute, she said that. But I loved it. Anyway, I have it, and I would be glad to turn it over to you. Because I want to get rid of it. I have so much stuff because I did so many things. I have so much stuff that I want it to be in the right hands of people that will appreciate it and not just destroy it.
No, we will not destroy it. I'm thinking of a Connie Ledgett collection.
She has enough stuff. I promise you.
Both for, you know, artifacts for display, you know, and then also online, because we have a large research.
Because I do, I have the Revolution stuff, and I have the Hurricane Hazel stuff, and I have, what else do I have? Oh, and I will tell you, the dude, this girl that, that Ed had the crush on anyway, and I were co-chairs for the Brunswick County Day at the World's Fair in Knoxville.
So was Lou's play, The Old Man and the Boy, was that performed?
I have that.
Was it performed there?
Yes, it was.
Yeah. I want to do that so bad here in this town.
Do you have a copy of it?
I do.
I do too, so yeah, I was going to say I'd give you mine. Oh, I'll give you mine anyway.
Yeah.
Yes, see, I asked him to do that for me. I called him up and I said, I am a co-chair of this, that, and I said, and what I'd like to do is have Robert Ruark, I'd like to have a play of Robert Ruark's Old Man and the Boy, Old Man and the Sea, Old Man and the Boy, whichever one it is. I can't keep him apart. And so he did, he wrote it for me. I mean, I just called him up and I said, this is what I need. And so he wrote it for me and sent it to me, and I got people to do the parts, and we performed it at the World's Fair. And I took him to sing. She went with me as a vocalist.
Oh, was it Brunswick County's?
Brunswick County. Yeah. And we had the Cedar Grove, we got the Cedar Grove Church Choir, which is a black church out in the county.
Oh, wow.
They blew the top off of that building that we were in. We were in like, it was like one of those big agriculture, anyway, big warehouse building we were in every county. So I was co-chair of Brunswick County's day at the World's Fair. North Carolina had the whole building, and anyway, it was the North Carolina booth, but they did each county one day. And so we were there for the day. We rented a bus and we put all these people on it and we took off to the World's Fair. And
I've never seen it, but I've read it. You know, it's
I don't know. See, back in those days, we probably didn't even film it or anything.
Yeah.
Because Valerie Swain's little boy, who is a big, a man now, was the little boy. And so we had to take our actress and everything, and he played the little boy. And I promised her I'd take real good care of him, so I did.
The end of that play will bring a tear to your eye. But, you know, the beginning is all the banter back and forth, just like The Old Man and the Boy. But, the end will bring a tear to your eye.
Yep, I did that. I did that day at the World's Fair, and the Cedar Grove Choir, I'm telling you, they were fabulous. And you know all those black resonant voices, how they must rock that church every But our bus was jumping up and down. Once they got accustomed to the rest of us, you know, that were on there with them, and they started singing up there. We had people to come back and say, what time does that choir sing again? I'm telling you, they knew we were there because that choir blew the roof off of that event, that building. And
that's great.
They were up there. But yeah, we did the Cedar Grove Choir and we did The Old Man and the Boy. And Kim sang. I forget what she sang, and Valerie McNabb went with me to accompany Kim, and I don't know what else we had in that, but those were the things that I took as part of it. I don't know if Carol got anything extra or not, but that was our main stuff. And yeah, I was real proud of that play, real proud of it. And I didn't think anybody else knew it had even happened. I'm glad to know that, Bob.
I have a habit of going through these materials that I spend more time reading than
I do actually
putting them into files and things like that. So I've done the last 10 years, I've done a lot of reading about Southport.
I bet. And there's a lot to know. I mean, Southport's so special. And then, you know, I ran the chamber for 5 years. So I was a busy little girl when I lived in Southport. But they did that with me. Baxter Strong, I don't know if you know these people I'm talking about. Baxter Strong ran the bank. And he was a good friend of mine, and he was on the board. You know, I probably know Wayne Berry, because he's still here. But the year I was going to be president of the festival, I went to the bank, and I said to Wayne, and it was early in the year, like maybe February, March, the bank to see Baxter, and I said, how much support are you going to give me for this festival? You know, I'm going to be, finally going to be president. And he said, you know you can always count on me. And I said, and he said, but before you do that, or no, after you finish with the festival, we want to see if you'll take that Chamber of Commerce and see what you can do with that. Because they've been struggling for years trying to get the chamber off the ground. And they hired a guy that was costing them a fortune, and they were getting nowhere. So I didn't know anything about Chamber of Commerce any more than I did about festivals when I started, but I learned quick. And so I said, well, let me think about that. And I went home and I was talking to Doug, and so he said, well, I think you ought to do it. I think you're perfect for it. So I went back and I see Baxter the next day, and I said, if I'm going to do the Chamber of Commerce, I want to do it now. I don't want to wait till after the festival, because that's the middle of tourist season. And if I'm going to get the chamber in order, I need to do it before tourist season. So he said, what you got in the festival? I said, I can do both of them, don't worry about it. If y'all are serious, you better let me know now. So the next day, Wayne Berry called me and he said, I think we need to have a meeting. So I went there. He said, we don't have any money, you know. I did know that. He said, we don't have any money. And here's what I need to know. How much of your time can we buy for $125? He said, we can pay you $100 a week and $25 non-taxable for your expenses. And I said, let me go home and talk to Doug about it. So I did that again, and I called him back and I said, I'll tell you what, I'm going to say 3 days, but let's just say 3 days. 3 days for $100, man, you know better than that. But I had a beauty shop, too, that I was running at the same time. And so, but I said, I want to do it. So I'm going to do it. And Doug encouraged me. So we went out there and cleaned that place up, me and Doug. I mean, their office, they just used it for storage. It was terrible. So we had to go out there, their little building, and get an order. And he mowed the yards. And anyway, back then, you know, he supported me in everything. So everything was really good. But I told Wayne I'd take it. Baxter still teases him to this day. He said, anytime I'm getting ready to hire somebody at the bank, I want you to come and help me. I want you to come and negotiate it for me. So anyway, I went to the chamber, and I worked out there for 5 years. But while I was out there, I joined the Tribal Council of North Carolina, and they put me in line to be president when I left to be the chamber. And I loved it. We did trade missions to different states on behalf of the travel industry in North Carolina, and we would go and take food, North Carolina food, and feed these delegations of travel writers and travel, all kinds of travel people that wrote about travel, and people that put together travel people you know.
Travel guides.
I can't think of all of it, but I got the, through Cash Garoon, I got the crab industry in North Carolina to send crab fingers. And it